forgiven, drowning out the Amazon rain. The song of Asian believers, filled with God's holy fire. It's every tribe, every tongue, every nation, a love song born of a grateful choir. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, He reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, He reigns. Let it rise above the four winds, caught up in the heavenly sound. Let praises echo from the towers of cathedrals to the faithful gathered underground. Of all the songs sung from the dawn of creation, some were meant to persist. Of all the bells rung from a thousand steeples, none rings truer than this. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, He reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, He reigns. And all the powers of darkness trembled at what they just heard. All the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, He reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, He reigns. Children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, He reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, He reigns. It's all God's children singing. Children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, He reigns.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. God was going to say, amen. Just praise the Lord. Thank you, Miss Kaylee. Thank you, Miss Candace. Amen. I tell you, when the world gives us a mold how we should be, right? Amen. But God says, break that mold. Amen. Thank you, Miss Caitlin. Amen. This time I'm going to turn it over to Cash.
All right. I'm going to probably be a little louder. All right. Yeah, that's probably going to be the best idea anyway. I really didn't know what I was going to say to y'all this morning. I sat down three or four times and got my Bible out and started looking. And then I'd get my pen out and I was going to write some things, and it just didn't feel right. And I went to all of the proof texts that people use at ordinations, and that didn't feel right. And then when I went to bed last night, and I don't know if any of y'all have been struggling with the enemy, but boy, I tossed and turned all night. I had a terrible headache down here to where I really could hardly see anything under my right eye, and I had just nightmares all night long. I woke up this morning feeling about as unholy and out of sorts as anybody could be. And then somebody sent this video of a wedding down in Brazil. And when the bride came walking in with her dad, the dad was wearing a tallit or a prayer shawl like she's got. And the bride was singing in another language, Yeshua, over and over again. Yeshua, that's Jesus' proper name given to him in Hebrew. And she was singing, I'm your wife. I love you. Come dance with me. And the dad made it about halfway down the aisle with her while she was doing that. And you could see the groom's face just beaming. And he was just so, he was worshiping the Lord, looking up while she was coming down the aisle. And the dad stopped halfway down the aisle and threw his hands up and started shouting and praising God. The whole thing turned into a knockdown, drag-out worship service instead of a wedding. And I felt better. And I feel like myself again, and I don't have the blinding headache, and the nightmares don't really matter. But I wanted to address y'all, and I wanted to address y'all too, because we don't do ordinations that's just an ordination. It's a worship service, and everybody can be part of it. And I found this chapter that I've used over and over again. I never realized it's absolutely perfect to bring a message for deacons or ministers or the congregation. Because you know what? The Lord's going to come get his bride pretty doggone soon, folks. I don't know if you've looked around and seen how this world is getting so out of, I mean, they're out of their mind, and it's getting worse and worse and worse. And he's eventually going to come and take his bride out of here. And so we need to be equipped, all of us, not just our deacons, but all of us, until he does. We're not to be sitting down and twiddling our thumbs. We're supposed to be serving him and busy doing things for the kingdom of God until he comes and gets us. And so the writer here in Hebrews chapter 12 says to you, to me, to all of us, wherefore seeing we are compassed about or circled about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily besets us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. First thing he said, and I tell you this morning, particularly when you accept this position, everybody is going to be watching you. And you know what most people are watching you for? They want to see you do something stupid. They can watch me for 5 minutes and I'll do something stupid for them if they want to see that. But then there are also some people, they want to see what is different about you. And they may want that. And they can get saved by watching what you do. And so realize that you're being circled about with a great cloud of witnesses, not only here, but the Bible says in heaven they're watching us too. They're watching us like from the grandstands, and all of the people that have died in the Lord and have gone on before us are watching us, and the angels are watching us. And so it is a great cloud of witnesses. And then it says, because of that, let's lay aside every weight. The things that hold you down, that weigh you down, you need to lay it aside. I don't care who hears this. If there is something in your life that is holding you back, you need to get rid of it. It's not worth it, what it's doing to you. And it said, in the sin which so easily besets us. The one thing I hate about that is the devil knows what will beset you, every one of you. He knows what you are likely to do. He knows your weaknesses. But the Lord knows what they are too, and he's able to help you overcome that. And so run from the sin that you are likely to do, the sin that besets you, that sets you back, that undoes you. Get rid of that out of your life. And the Bible says it's up to us to do that. You know, you can say, Lord, help me, but we have the power to set aside those things that we're not supposed to do. We can't blame that on the devil. That's us. That's on us. Okay? And then, this is really awesome. Let us run the race that is set with patience, the race that is set before us. We have the most diversified group of deacons in any church I've ever been in, big or small. And each of you have a race that the Lord wants you to run. And I believe that deacons should handle a lot of the duties in the church that gets shoved on the pastor. And that's why a lot of pastors are burning out and quitting. More pastors are resigning and leaving the ministry than are joining the ministry nowadays. That's a shame. There should be more joining. There shouldn't be anybody leaving and resigning, but it's true. They're burning out. Because a lot of times a local church, even a small one or a large one, they think that the pastor has to handle everything, and he can't do that. He can't do that. Even if he has assistant pastors, they can't do all of that. You know, I kind of learned the way that structure works by looking at the Navy. I know y'all ain't Navy, neither one of y'all, but excuse me if I use that analogy, but don't get offended. We got Army and Marines over here, okay? But they have a group of people on the ship, the petty officers, and then the chief petty officers, and there's several ranks of that. And a Navy man told me one time that they literally run everything, that the ship would sink if it wasn't for those petty officers. Matter of fact, they are so valuable that the captain won't even let his commanders run their mouth at them for fear that they might not do anything and the ship would just shut down. And so they are so important. And I'm not saying that deacons are necessarily petty officers, but they handle the work of the church. When I look at our food bank could not operate without our deacons. It couldn't. Couldn't do it. When we have clothing drives, when we get together things to benefit the people in the neighborhood, the deacons handle that. The pastors get involved too, but the deacons do that. The security of our church is upon our deacons to make us safe where we can sit in here. You notice I got these two sitting where they can watch that door even though they're not back there. They can hit dead on at 25 yards. So if you see one of them draw, duck real fast, okay? and that gives us the ability to be safe. Because quite frankly, you're not safe in the house of God no more. Not unless you've got a good security team. And these two right here, I trust with my life. Ain't no question about that. I know they got my back, my front, my side, everything else in here. They're going to watch over it. It is up to the deacons to teach the children. We've got one that y'all only see her every few weeks or so. And I don't get it. She's up there. She usually sometimes has 10 children in the nursery. She does it in Sunday school, the Sunday service, Wednesday night, and then she babysits 7 of them all day long in her house.
Man, that's amazing.
I'd be out of my mind. If I had to work that nursery one Sunday, y'all would find me in the corner in a fetal position, sucking my thumb and crying like one of them babies. Matter of fact, when I used to work as a substitute teacher, I cannot believe that I volunteered to do a K-5 class one day. 25 5-year-olds. And I was in there and everything had to be structured. If you did anything out of turn that the teacher had set up, the kids would go nuts. And I didn't know that. And I jostled things around a little bit, you know, and the kids were freaking out. And I went, whoa, what's wrong? And they said, well, Miss So-and-so does it this way, does it that way, does it that way. And by lunchtime, I was about ready to pull my hair out. And I was sitting back there at my desk, and a little 5-year-old boy comes up and sits on my knee and looks at me, and he said, I want my mama. And I looked at him, and I said, I want my mama, too. So my hat goes, I did say that, and he looked real upset, like, what's that? Never mind. But he went and sat down and got quiet. But I'm saying this, they are in charge of, they do our Bible schools, they do our nurseries, they do our, they teach our youth. There are so many different things. They prepare communion. They help distribute that and participate in the services. They are prayer warriors. They do all sorts of things. And only the Lord knows what all He's going to do with you guys in the days to come. He's going to show you things that He wants you to do. And so I say to the church, get behind them and help them. And we always need, I mean, biblical deacons. That's what we need, a lot of them. Roger Blanchard was the first deacon that we ever ordained. And he's a minister now. But we waited 7 years after we started the church before we ordained a deacon, because I had been so burned by them in the other churches I'd been in, because they were not doing what the Bible told them to do. Diane's husband took a Bible and read it to this huge church one night, what the work of a deacon was supposed to be, and it got so quiet, and he told that church, he said, there isn't a biblical deacon in this entire building, and if there is, come up here and take this Bible out of my hand and prove it to me. And they couldn't do it because they were doing everything to tear down the church rather than to build it up. And a deacon's job is to build it up and to work with the pastor and carry out the vision. And I'm glad that we have deacons here that are doing that. They are. Praise God for them. And so, in the days ahead, you should run with patience the race that's set before you. Whatever God is showing you to do, because there's loads of things that need to be done in this church. And then it says, here's what you need to do while you're running the race. And everybody in here has a race. Not just the deacons, but everybody in here. You've got something that God wants you to do to help build up the body of Christ. We don't come to church just to warm the pew. He gives us all something that we can do to contribute to the work here, to the people, to help lift each other up, and to make the church, the local church, run. And it says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. That's who we need to look to. I realize that we all look up to other people sometimes, but you know what? You look long enough, they're going to let you down. They're human. They're fallible. So if you keep your eyes on Jesus, then there's no way I can run you off. Well, he rolled his eyes at me. He didn't shake my hand. I'm quitting. But you know what? If you're the real thing, God will drag you right back every time. Look to Jesus. He is the ultimate example. Listen to what he says. Who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. He went through it. He went through stuff that we will never go through, so we wouldn't have to. And so anytime a disappointment comes along or a problem comes along, don't freak out and run off. Stay the course. Jesus did, and he made the path so much better for you. Hang in there. Keep serving God. Lord, I have resigned from this church, I think it was 3 times, and nobody ever knew it. I did try it one time with the elders years ago. 20-some years ago, I tried resigning. And I was sitting down there in my office all in tears. I was just burned out. I'd had enough. And they come down there and read my resignation and laughed at me. And one of them balled it up and threw it in the trash can. I wish I'd have kept that. And they said, get up back upstairs. And they hugged me and prayed for me and then sent me back upstairs. And then the other 2 times I resigned, I never gave it to anybody. I just kept it for myself, and then I throwed it away. Don't give up on the work, because Jesus did not give up on you. And he will not give up on you. He will be there for you. And so look to him when you get discouraged. Everybody's going to get discouraged at one time or another. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your mind. So anytime you think, well, you know, this job that God has given me to do, I'm just so tired and weary of it, think about what Jesus put up with. And that'll cheer you up. That'll help it so much better. You have not resisted unto blood, striving against sin. And you have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children, my son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when you are rebuked of him. For whom the Lord loves, he chastens, and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. That's good old-fashioned English for getting a whipping from God. I got a really good, solid whipping from God. Let's see, how old was I? I wanted to see. Oh, Lord. I was 27 years old when I got my big whipping from God. I'm 62. And I still remember it like it was yesterday evening. He didn't do it to hurt me. He did it to wake me up, to get my attention, to listen to what he had called me to do, and for me to do what he had called me to do. And I said, I will, Lord. I'm sorry for running and from ignoring you. I'll do what you asked. And since that day, I've never stepped back, nor will I. It's been 30, I'm trying to do the math. I only went to public school. It's 35 years. Thank you. And it's been the best 35 years of my life. Boy, he turned everything around when I listened to him. And sometimes God has to do that with us when we won't listen. And again, God is not the boogeyman up there trying to hurt you, trying to ruin your life. He's trying to save you, and he's trying to save your life, and he's trying to give you the right way to go. And so endure those things when he corrects you, when in whatever form it may be. Listen to him and don't walk away from him, because he's got your best interest at heart. And so, basically, in closing, I would just say to the deacons, the new deacons, to the old deacons, to the congregation, man, don't run the race that's set before you. Don't give up. Hang in there, because it's not going to be very long to where God the Father is going to look at Jesus and said, it's time for you to go get your bride. You know, because like I said, I see things right now in prophecy that tells me it could be any minute, not any day or any year. It could be any minute now. It really could be. The things that the Bible said had to happen before Jesus would come for his church in the rapture, it has happened. It has happened. So we're just waiting right now for him to come get us. But while we are waiting, the Bible tells us not to be idle, but to be busy serving him. And there's so much that we have on our heart to do here, and we need the help to do it. And I thank God for these that have come and said, I'll do it. And so this morning, we're going to formally ordain them as deacons of Solid Rock Baptist Church. And having said that, I'm going to ask, first of all, if all of the ordained staff, whoever you may be, if you're ordained in another church, it don't make any difference, to form a line back down this way. Honey, would you come? And then anybody else that would like to come and lay hands on them and pray for them, then you come in right behind them as well. Join us and come and lay hands on them. Let me cut this mic.
Reigns.
Our.